Dear students, as we all know that these days we are very much engaged with talking of virtue, that is a very splendid poem written by George Herbert, and we are also just very much talking about the essentiality of virtue in human life. So we cannot say that it is just the poem that we should enjoy. Rather, it is the poem that we should take very carefully, that it may guide our life to the pinnacle of a very good spiritual life. So I am going to have a very much different kind of observation that I have made through the poem, and I can understand that this is a very reformative poem that is meant for reforming our attitude related to our belief in life and its immortality. So the poet has envisioned or imagined the most beautiful things or natural phenomena which take place to please us. We are always fond of sweet day, sweet rose, and sweet spring. Who is here who do not like all these kind of things? Knowing the fact that they are going to die very soon, it is that kind of existentialism that we should understand, that this physical achievement is just holding good only for short span of time. You know, we can say that the poet is talking about the nice day that is simply be gotten by the wedding of earth and sky. This is a very unique image that the poet has given us, and you know that despite the fact that we know all these kind of things, that our life is short, as is the life of nice day, we are not concerned with making our life prosper into a sublime spiritual life. We are least bothered of embellishing our life with virtuous action, with virtuous thought. Maybe it is a kind of lamentation that the poet is making in the first three stanzas, or it is just an eye-opener for all of us to be alert of our engagement in the false achievement of life. But ultimately we should know that night is to come. When night comes, day goes off, no matter how nice or how brilliant that day is. And when day is gone, it is just the weeping and weeping for the loss that we have made of the beautiful thing. That do you weeps for the reason that the sweet day dies at night and morning sheds tears of morning? So it has been taking place that we have been only lamenting our loss of valuable life. As we find here that the tears are shedding, these are all the tears of mourning, lamentation. These are weeping. but that doesn't mean anything. When we lose the chance of making our life sublime, there is no benefit of weeping for the loss. So here there is an important point to notice at this juncture, that we have been repeating the same kind of mistake time and again. We have doing the same kind of action which has been inherited, and it is all due to inheritance. We are dominantly concerned with our physical achievements, then our spiritual reformation for making a virtuous soul and so on. Now, it is also the point that the poet brings out an image of serene and invigorating day for the celestial and terrestrial or mundane delight together to reader. You know, we find that it is all for a celestial region that the poet has just cited this example, that the best is to come. These are the things which are just providing lots of pleasure to us, but still the best is to come, and the best is not known. We are not actually paying as much attention to the best thing as we should. So we find that there are some points to observe, that life moves to death, and every moment you are moving to death. Actually, with birth we are moving to death, and it is what the two sides of our existence are. We simply cannot ignore. With construction, the process of destruction starts. With a day, the process of coming of night starts, and so on. It is just the cyclical process in which we have been spending our lives. Yes, we are passive. We are passively just present in day, in night, but we are not thoughtful. We are not going to make any kind of stand on the way that we are adopting or spending our life. So we need to be celestially more concerned with the way that we are spending our time. Sometime momentarily we are getting certain kind of pleasure out of certain action, and we think that it is what we are just born for, but it is not the reality. We are just simply endeavoring for that sort of delight which does not last long. When it is the sweet day, we want to stay in the sweet day, but it doesn't stay any longer when the night falls. And still when the night falls, we are waiting for the day, or sweet day rather. This is a kind of habitual action that we have been making and making. But we can say that this is all natural phenomenon which is naturally taking place. But our life is also a kind of natural phenomenon. With life, death comes. These are two natural incidents which are complementary to each other. We cannot say that life is always going to move on and death is to be avoided. No, the thing which has the complementary existence is totally subject to destroy. So within construction we find that the seed of destruction is sowed. So what the actual thing is, that there are some essential points to observe that nightfall has been used as metaphor for death. You know, we can say, and the term die itself has been used by the poet in the poem, "Die Must Die." And it is what we should just take very seriously. It is just the repetition that poet is making again and again, for just making the idea set in our mind that it should echo all the time when we are trying to do something. So we should say that the fall has been described as real cause of death in the Judeo-Christian history of the creation. There too we find, and almost in every religious text, there is a story of creation. And scientifically too, we have seen that something important takes place for some time, then it is complete destruction of that important thing, and then once again we are just very much or very badly engaged into something creative. But it is whatever creation we are making, it has only been limited to certain a span of time. So the evening dew has been charged with emotion, and tears are referring to grief, to having shed at nightfall over the fall or sin which owes to death. So we can say that we make our life sinful. Knowingly or unknowingly, we are committing lots of sins in our life. And it is what the fall of our life is. Here we cannot say that by fall the poet means only the physical death. Once we are committing sins, we are just making our virtue fall. We are making our just what you can call soul fall. Soul, although being detached from all these actions, it is said that soul does not remain attached to the action of human being. But ultimately, I think that it cannot be unaffected either, because it is residing in the body through which we are committing lots of sins. So when our body is sinful, or we are committing some sinful activities through our bodily action, I cannot say that the soul is really not very much affected by this kind of thing. Or maybe we can say that it is affected to the extent that we lose our sense of listening to the voice or clarion call that soul is making for us, or we are just getting deeper to listen to all the sounds, all the ripples, all the musics of soul. Then it is what, you know, the fall of our life is, that when we stop listening to the melodious music of the soul, we can say that we are going to make it fall and fall and fall. So at 11th hour we are just simply shedding tears, because when everything is gone, we have played our part, and we are just to depart from this world, or the night is to fall or death is to come. We are evaluating what work has been done and for what purpose, and how much just celestial achievement we have made. We find it is big zero. We have not made anything. We are departing from here as we are born, or even we are just it is worse than we are born. So the point is that it is no wastage of the whole life. If we could not maintain our virtuous sublimity with which we are born, maybe with death everything is just sinful, because that just what you can call pure soul just becomes mute, and it does not speak out anything, or even if it speaks out, we are dumb enough to listen to that sound. Now, so it is only just the time of revision of the whole life's work, when the night is to fall, when death is waiting for us, and we say that sorry, we have spent it sinfully, and then except that kind of repentance, we do not do anything. And it is not in this life only that we have done this kind of thing. I think of the poet is of the view that we have been almost doing the same kind of mistakes lives after lives. And after just traveling through many lives, we have not just spiritually developed just any further, and we are standing where we had been some 10 lives back, and so on. So the point is that through the same but different kind of example of sweet, lovely, bright, delightful red rose, we also find that the same lesson is imparted for us. The red color dazzles, and it represents angry mood of the flower, and it is a splendid look which ensnares outlookers. And we can say that it is ensnaring onlookers. They are simply charmed, ensnared by the splendid look of the rose. Yes, it is for that momentary achievement that we are committing lots of sin. We find that we are not going to just talk about the right path and wrong path. So it is not about the righteous way that we have been ever thinking when we are talking about making life rosy and something like that. We want to make other, we want to make onlookers dazzled by our achievement. That how great achievement, physically speaking, we have achieved. I think that it is to make other influence we are doing the sinful activities. People are not aware of making any kind of sublime judgment. We do not find that people are able to do, or all people are able to do that kind of thing. Maybe there are few who are just able to just judge our life from that standpoint of view. But we can say that it is not with general mass that we can see everything. A general mass is very badly and very keenly interested for that momentary fame of life that onlookers are always dazzled to see. Instead of looking at our inner existence, a spiritual existence, we are just waiting for the recommendation of the onlookers about our acts. We are just parasitic in that recommendation. We are not just trying to think that it is my life, so let me take my decision. I am the person who is to take decision, and I am the person who is to form our life in a very much virtuous manner, because it is here that we are also going to do our duty. So loss of, duty, sense of duty has been very much a negative effect on the just making of this life fall. So once again you find that onlookers are surprised to see just angry mood and a splendid look of rose. But talking about the spring, the poet says that it is full with sweet day, colorful and fragrant flowers, And all these things have been compared with a box full of sweets. So how sweet it is, how sweet is the day of spring that we can imagine that it is as if a box very much full with sweets had been handed over to us to enjoy. It is only pleasure and pleasure that we find into spring. We do not find that there is any misery, any woe for anybody else when spring comes. Rather, we are all thinking about the arrival of just a season like a spring season to make itself happy or to make other happy as well. So point remains very much clear that this kind of similar explanation that you find like a box full of sweets is once again just said or enough for attraction of the common people. And in all these quatrains, the speaker deals with delight due to rich bounty or gift on the earth. So God has almost made this earth replete with so many bounty or gift with which we can make our life enjoy. And it is not for a sublime delight that has been ever concerned for the common people. So everything is okay. We should be very much part of that delight. But that is only for short period. If this physical phenomenon can make us delight to this extent that we lose everything, although it is temporarily, why should we not think of the permanent delight that we can find by making our life virtuous, by making our soul virtuous? Here the delight is manifold, just increased than the delight that you find living in the vicinity of clear day and vicinity of sweet rose and sweet spring. So we can say that it is the last quatrain in which there is an image of eternal soul. How to make this soul feel proud? That is the important point that we should think about. We find that we have even sold our soul for ordinary success in our life. We do not listen to the voice coming from our soul that let us not do the thing which is not virtuous. But we have actually sold everything. We have actually sold our soul also, that we can say that we are just losing everything. All the sense is lost, and we find that it is once again metaphorical explanation that we find by a seasoned timber which cannot be burned and change into coal. So it remains unchangeable, you know, because it has faced lots of weathering, and just a seasoned timber has been so strong that it is not going to last because it has faced, it has confronted lots of ups and downs due to weathering. But here we are just not going to invite odds in our life, or because of making our life is just splendid. We are not just in search of a splendor of life. So we can say that we let the world be changed into coal, but our soul should remain ever. If that be the principle of life and that be the situation of thought of life, we can say that it will be just like lighting the lamp which is kept unburned in our soul. So in our soul there is a light kept unburned, and we spend whole life keeping it unburned. But the poet has a suggestion. The poet has to say that let it be burned, that it will be burning and burning and burning ever, that no other factor is going to act upon all these things and make it just a blow out for any particular region. So we can just simply burn the very much unburned lamp of our soul by our actual feeling, actual religious temperament. We should develop that kind of thing, and once that light is burned, it cannot be blown out by no just forceful or any sort of temper. We can make it blow out. It is not the tempest event that is so powerful to blow out the lamp which has been burnt by the heat of virtuous deed and so on. So we should take that kind of thing in this way, and we should try to understand.